Good afternoon. Thank you all for joining, especially the ones who volunteered to join without any class pressure. This year's Robert L. Hess Scholar in Residence Program invites Rob Nixon. Rob Nixon received his PhD from Columbia University and is the author of 4 books. His most recent book, Slow Violence and the Environmentalism of the Poor, has received 4 prizes and several other honors. He taught at the University of Wisconsin-Madison for 16 years and almost a decade before at Columbia University. Last year, he joined the faculty at Princeton University. Professor Nixon is a frequent contributor to the New York Times. His writing has also appeared in publications such as The New Yorker, Atlantic Monthly, London Review of Books, Village Voice, The Nation, and many others. Professor Nixon has been a recipient of a Fulbright Hayes Fellowship, a MacArthur Foundation Peace and Security Fellowship, and a National Endowment for Humanities Fellowship. He was also awarded a Guggenheim Fellowship, which he declined. I could go on and on, but the point is, we are privileged this week to have someone whose work has traveled the globe, and we look forward to his contributions today. Let's have a round of applause for Professor Nixon.
Lewis, for allowing me to visit your classes and participate in this conversation. You all have had the chance to read the piece that I sent you, and I know that both classes have received prompts and questions from the professors in question. But we thought we'd just to kind of ground some of this information about the Anthropocene debates, I thought we would start with a short video that would just give a very quick overview of how it's often presented.
This is the story of how one species changed a planet. The latest chapter of our story begins in England 250 years ago. Fueled by coal, then oil, several brilliant inventions appeared. They ignited the Industrial Revolution, which spread like wildfire through Europe, North America, Japan, then elsewhere. The great railways, then cars and highways, connected people across the globe. Medical discoveries saved millions of lives. New artificial fertilizers meant we could feed more people. Population rose rapidly. But this was nothing compared with what was to come. The 1950s marked the beginning of the Great Acceleration. Globalization, marketing, tourism, and huge investments helped fuel enormous growth. People swarmed to cities, which became even more powerful engines of creativity. In a single lifetime, the well-being of millions has improved beyond measure. Health, wealth, security, longevity, never have so many had so much. Yet 1 billion are malnourished. In a single lifetime, we have grown into a phenomenal global force. We move more sediment and rock annually than all natural processes, such as erosion and rivers. We manage 3/4 of all land outside the ice sheets. Greenhouse gas levels this high have not been seen for over 1 million years. Temperatures are increasing. We have made a hole in the ozone layer. We are losing biodiversity. Many of the world's deltas are sinking due to damming, mining, and other causes. Sea level is rising. Ocean acidification is a real threat. We are altering Earth's natural cycles. We have entered the Anthropocene, a new geological epoch dominated by humanity. This relentless pressure on our planet risks unprecedented destabilization. But our creativity, energy, and industry offer hope. We have shaped our past. We are shaping our present. We can shape our future. You and I are part of this story. We are the first generation to realize this new responsibility. As the population grows to 9 billion, we must find a safe operating space for humanity, for the sake of future generations. Welcome to the Anthropocene.
Preliminary feedback from the audience based on what you just saw. Any initial responses or feelings regarding the video or the idea of the Anthropocene?
So then when the Anthropocene says, like, oh, this is a result of human or human species, then I think that that's just actually something that's my initial reaction to.
Yeah, I think that's a great starting point. Probably the most frequently used word in the video is we. And so, you know, maybe as sociologists, as urban studies as students, one of the things we learn to do is to unpack the power differentials within every we. And so this is very, very big scale. I mean, it's always the planets out there, and there's us. And so how do we bring power, as you say, how do we bring histories of settler colonialism, of slavery, of gender inequalities, and how do those factor into this idea, which originated with the sciences? So it came from ecology, it came from atmospheric chemistry, which is about as global as it gets. How do we bring it down to where people are living, and how do we ask questions, how do we push back against the scientists' idea of what this is all about, and we introduce questions of governance, introduce questions of other ways of living, and who has contributed most heavily and who has contributed most lightly. Even the imagery, I think, keeps coming back to Europe as a single origin. And there's a Indian writer called Amitav Ghosh, who recently did a wonderful series of video lectures from the University of Chicago on the suppression of industrialization in Asia by European colonial powers, and how that it's not just about the spreading out osmotically of the fruits of modernity, but it's also about the history of colonial efforts to prevent people getting access to things like the cotton industry, various other, so there's not this tends to often have a single genealogy, and from my point of view, one of the risks of letting the scientists talk about it from a species level is that it doesn't acknowledge the different starting points. You can have an Indian-centered account that would be very different, or an African or Latin American descent. And as you say, there are these other attitudes, other mindsets and other political formations that are very different from the kind of extractivist capitalist mindset. So if there's anybody else who'd like to contribute on this very big issue, maybe that's something we could follow up on.
I'd like to raise the point, very topic, the anthropocene is a conversation mostly held by white men.
Yeah.
And here we are in a room where white men are the minority, yet we're talking about the anthropocene. So I want, I guess, some type of feedback or idea of how some of the students are thinking about this large-scale question of where we've been and where we're going. So I want to keep the attention of the students for a little bit. Sabrina, what do you think? Just in terms of history of where we are today and just being able to have this type of conversation, is it important to us in our daily lives?
I mean, it is important because things are definitely changing. We want to know what the media can tell us, what the future is going to hold. So, you know, what is it? And I don't know if it's really going to exist.
Question of existence, right? Mm-hmm. Certainly. Who else?
So this is sort of like a question that talks about some of these issues, and it's sort of, how can we combat the perception that environmental protection is at odds with improving the quality of life of desperate workers under the current system? A lot of people most affected by issues around the Anthropocene are, you know, we talk of indigenous communities in Latin America and the excuse sociological term like the periphery. So how can we combat, you know, people needing to fish sharks for fins to make money versus protecting the sharks as a species? Because one of the big arguments is there's a lot of jobs in environmentally destructive practices. And it's how can you just say, you know, don't do these jobs. It's easy to say that from a privileged position because you don't need that job. But if you do, then how do we combat this tension?
Yeah, we'd like the answer to that.
Sure. Okay. Well, I think one of the key elements is consultation and the you can't have a top-down idea of one environmentalism headquartered in DC or Geneva or Seattle or wherever it is. And I think for me, one of the most encouraging things has been the rise of indigenous movements and the way they're connecting transnationally through social media and so forth. And part of that is that they are saying, okay, we have environmental traditions, but they're different traditions. And so the question of employment is not a one model fits all idea. Each culture is making located choices rather than saying greening is good, therefore you must stop defending sharks. And so I think like any social change, it depends on a lot of listening. And rather than saying this is the red line, that's environmental, this isn't environmental. And so, for instance, you know, in some parts of Latin America, like Ecuador in particular, they have a law protecting the rights of all living forces, so that they have non-human rights. And there was a case not long ago where the plaintiff in the court was a river, and the river won the case. Okay, so that's a different mindset completely. Okay, because the indigenous people said the river is alive, and the river has rights, and that's not the mining company's position or the dam building company's position. And so I was talking to an Ecuadorian activist, and she was saying that even though you can't see that happening on the ground all the time, that symbolically to jerk people out of what seems like the only way of thinking was really, really important. And that people, indigenous people, felt there was some high court validation of their relations. And so I think, you know, sometimes we get stuck in jobs versus environment because that's what the right sells us. And sometimes that's true, as you say. But other times there are, like with alternative energies, there are other ways of finding jobs, but those are not the industries that are subsidized, and all the subsidies go to big oil and that. But I think this question of listening to other ways of inhabiting the environment is a key part of what you're asking, as I get it. Anybody else want to pick up?
Can I just add to that? I mean, I agree that this idea of indigenism is the area where we perhaps have the biggest hope in terms of creating the symbolic opportunities for going forward in a different way. But if you think of, I mean, what you wrote about with globalization and the power of the bosses of the biosphere, even though we have these symbols, I think what happens on the ground is, in fact, that the bosses of the biosphere win. So, for example, even in Ecuador, where they have these laws, the state continues to take lands from indigenous people in order to mine and drill, and this is in the name of things that we're in favor of, because they're actually distributing the profits to the people. And so even in this case that is in fact quite special and unique and hopeful, we have the setup as being, we need these resources for the good of the people. And so I don't mean to be dark, but it seems dark even in our best case.
Okay, does anybody else want to? Is another mic we could circulate so more people can talk?
Oh, yeah.
A week ago in our class, we watched a video of the 2012 opening ceremony for the Olympics, which started with this depiction of the Industrial Revolution, and it took you through these stages of history. And the whole narrative was one of progress, right? And the question is, how much of this can be seen as progress, where that's the constant message that we're getting? Are there other discourses happening that we should know about, but also one in which they could be engaged in, especially where they have daily experiences in which they might not think about it in such a way, but it's certainly connected?
Does anybody want to take that one?
Well, let's start with some of the concerns that we all have as students and see how they might relate to the larger question, right? So things that we talk about in class. Danny, what are some of the things that you experience, think about in class, but how can we think about them in a larger frame? Certainly, capitalism is a central
thing. You know what I'm thinking if we're going to reverse this, do we have to like change like our political system from like capitalism to like a different thing else, like socialism or something? Like, could we like reverse this negative effect with capitalism? I'm sorry if I just, that's what I came to mind.
And we were just talking about this in our class too, that could you have green capitalism that would in fact improve the system?
I think it's difficult though, because like even within different political systems, like if you look at Europe, it's much more socialist than the US, and certainly like some countries, like I know Germany has like a lot of renewables, I believe, and they've been able to do that because they have a lot of support for that, but they're still all developed countries. Like they have a slightly different political system than we do, and like maybe significantly different interests and focuses than we do in our country, but I lost my train of thought. But I was going to say, but they also are still developed, so they're still like consuming a lot of resources. They are still consuming on almost probably, if not the same scale that we are as a country. So I don't know if changing the political system, I mean, I think you do need to change the political system, but I don't think it can really look like anything that we've seen before within a developed nation, because consumption is the problem, not just capitalism itself.
We have this mic down.
Oh, fantastic. Okay. Yeah, that'd be great. I think, yeah.
Who wants the next? You have that.
Did you have your
hand? So, put it to you.
Yeah.
Can green capitalism get us out of this?
I'm more sort of in Naomi Klein's camp, in her book Climate versus Capitalism, where she's saying that, in a sense, if we have a crisis, you have, she talked about in the shock doctrine, people interested in creating crises in order to profit from them, okay? Whether we think of Katrina or whatever, they see it as an opportunity often to bring in the private contractors, to privatize, to redistribute, to gentrify, to displace, all of those things. So that's the one thing about crisis. The other thing about crisis is it can also create an opportunity for, at a grassroots level, at a street level, for people to assert their values, to defect from a system that clearly hasn't worked, hasn't protected them. And so it's that dynamic of like crisis as an opportunity for profiteering by those who already have too much, versus the crisis that allows for a kind of a dissidence, and it allows for an opportunity to remodel the value system, the priority system. I mean, even if you take something like Superstorm or Hurricane Sandy, and the idea that you can do without government, okay, then suddenly, you know, the lights go out, buildings are flooded. Who's responsible? You know, is this libertarianism? Is libertarianism going to solve this? You know, you have to rethink, what does government mean? Where has government been underfunded? Where has it failed? Why does it answer urgent, desperate requests from some communities before other communities? All those questions come alive in a very immediate way.
I'm not a student, but I speak very loud. Do you need it?
Yes, voice.
No, because I find it fascinating. But I have four things that I would like to bring up. One, I was very young but I don't remember then, the C conference happened in Caracas, Venezuela, maybe 1970-something. I think I was in the university. And I remember reading about, the big thing for that conference was the fish factories, you know, these huge ships that they kind of have these huge nets, and they just take the deep of the sea, and they just take everything. And the conference was about how many meters will they allow them to go, but basically they were doing it illegally, and that conference say you can go all the way down. And so that happened is that killed the regular fishing of fishermen and fisherwomen that did it for local consumption. So fishing was a local consumption, and they maybe local consumption means the country, all right? Then these huge fish factories came in, destroyed the whole bottom of the sea, just like that. Let's destroy the whole bottom of the sea. Another thing is, I made my thesis, it was a photography book. Caracas has a mountain that it looks, this way looks to Caracas, and that way to go to the sea. So they have these flower plantations, right? And doing the research, because it's forbidden, the park law in Venezuela forbidden for people to live in the park. But we have two parks that have, one have fishermen, and the other one has these flower growers. So what they find out one day is that the flower growers actually stop for the land to slide, like the mudslide that became very famous. Okay. So I go a few years ago, I've been here for 32 years, I made that book, and then I came here, I went up once, they, oh, let's go have lunch in Galipang, and I'm like, lunch in Galipang, that doesn't sound like. They allowed them to cultivate eucalyptus. And eucalyptus is one of the most damaging plants ever. So then, because it erodes everything. So instead of doing flower, which was stopping, so they allowed them, whatever government that thing. But the other thing that I would like to, so plastic bags. A student of mine doing something on plastic bag in my documentary class. I remember a world that didn't have that many plastic bags. If you're older than 50, you remember a world, but your mother will go to the supermarket with one cloth bag, so that, and the other thing is this film, I don't know if, you know, most likely, is manufacturing landscapes. And it's about a photographer working in China. And I think that China is one of the saddest, in terms of environment, because they repeat everything plus. All the mistakes that capitalism made, they repeat it plus. So in this film, you just see something that could have been avoided. Maybe they didn't know when the Industrial Revolution, maybe they didn't know in the use of, but China is repeating everything plus in the last 20 years. So I think it's quite an amazing, and I think it's about capitalism, and I think it's that to the exaggeration of the exploitation of all the resources for just, you know, I don't know, 200 people be millionaires. We could live in a more normal life without so much plastic bag and everything. I don't know if it was a question or a comment.
What do you want to?
Well, see, I'm not a manufactured basket, so I'm familiar with the film. I've seen it before. I also thought that it was pretty sad to see, like, the extent of damages that are being done, not only to the landscapes, but I thought, like, the factories themselves were, you know, pretty sad to see. But what struck me, what was sad about the movie, was not that they were doing these things, but that, like, again, it brings back the question I said before of the tensions between jobs and environmental degradation, is that they were making our products. So it's easy for the United States to say, you guys should lower your emissions and do this and that and the other thing, but these emissions are so high in these developing nations, like China, or China's, you know, pretty developed by now, but most of their emissions are coming from the factories that they're sending over here. So it's like, it's hard to say, you know, stop emitting, but then you also have to say, stop sending us things. If you don't want these giant factories with these millions or thousands of workers making, you know, one piece day in, day out, then you can't have cheap goods. Then you can't have this culture of mass consumption. So I almost don't blame them, because we are the market. And if we didn't buy all these things, then you could argue that their economy might look a little bit different, because then maybe they could specialize the other things. Maybe they could have just local farming. I mean, who knows? But that the situation is that we need things for this price because of our systems in place, and that is the best place to get it, and that is the best way to do it according to our current system. So it's hard to, I mean, yeah, I feel bad, but I mean, it's hard to even say that it's their fault per se, you know?
Yeah, I mean, in a weird way, China is such an extreme case that it's almost a hopeful case to a degree, and I qualify that. But, you know, there have been so many catastrophic events around mudslides, landslides, where the mountains have been denuded above industrial places, and people have just not thought about what would happen when the rains come and the mud comes down. And so there have been terrible casualties. And so what before were kind of natural checks on catastrophe have been stripped away. And so that complicates sometimes the idea of jobs versus environment, because if you choose jobs and you completely abuse the environment will come back and wreak casualties. And I think I read somewhere that there were 30,000 environmental protests in China last year. Okay, and by environmental we mean public health, security, air quality, water issues, all of these things. And so I think for a lot of people in China, what I'm hearing is that they say, okay, this dream of growth without consequences is not working. But as you quite rightly say, the consumers on the other end of the globe here are totally implicated in maintaining that system. And part of the challenge is seeing our implication and acting at this end in ways that connects with the way people are acting at that end.
Sorry, I just wanted to say something about structural racism, and that plays a major role here in the U.S. Do you think that is common in other countries besides here?
Yes, totally. And sometimes the sometimes the racism can be between religions, you know. Sometimes it can be tribal, intertribal. But a lot of it has to do with histories of colonialism, whether it's in Latin America, whether it's in Africa. And more it's complicated by the creation of a kind of elevated global elite that travels from in a separate zone, and people are assimilated from different cultures into that global elite, but it's still effectively founded on a history of structural racism without reparations. And one of the things with the climate justice movement that was very, very active in the Paris talks recently was that what they were calling for was what they call loss and damages. In other words, you don't just say we've got to fix the climate, but you've got to address the history of structural racism, of colonialism, of slavery, the history of countries contributing very unequally to these problems, and so I think that's a relevant way in which that is an important pressure point for the conversation about change.
I wanted to go back to talking about our capitalist economy, and I wanted to say that I think that our economy is like its own machine, in that it does what it wants to do regardless of consumers, and they're going to constantly produce. We don't have a say in how they produce, what they produce, and how much they produce. And I think if we had, like Professor Lewis was saying on Tuesday, we don't have the option when it comes to our transportation. We take the train because it's the simplest way to get around the city. If there weren't any highways for cars to go on there, we would just take the train. And that's what we do. So if we had no option but to do the right thing, then that's what we would do.
This is in environmental sociology classes where students say to me, you know, what can we do? I always try to take things out of the individual level and bring it up to the social level and say, if we want solutions, they need to be structural solutions. And you know, public transportation is a very obvious example of that. You know, if you live in the middle of Ohio, you don't have the option to take the subway to work because the subway doesn't exist, right? So that if people want to change their transportation patterns, the way to do is at the structural level where you need to organize above just what my individual choice is, and it needs to happen in communities and cities and larger structures. So that, you know, I'm not an advocate for the 100 things that I can do to lower my carbon footprint, though I think we should all be doing those. Included in that set of actions should be community building and political lobbying to make changes that affect more than just the individual person.
Yeah. I'm going to channel what I think is the thinking of my students. And before we get to the question of what should we do, maybe I'm going to ask the question, maybe what Sharika is thinking, why should I care? I'm here for school, I want to graduate and get a job, so why should I care? Especially living in New York City where the biodiversity isn't as much of a concern, or so we think.
Okay, There are many, many ideas of environmentalism, and in some ways, it's a word that comes with a lot of baggage. And because a lot of my work has been in Africa, I would constantly come up against green imperialism and green racism, people whose communities had been displaced in order to create national parks. And so, environmentalist means people who like animals more than they like people. That's you encounter that all over the place. So that's a very powerful and real history. But you also, so you have people like we were just talking about in the last session, Wangari Maathai and the Greenbelt Movement in Kenya, indigenous environmentalists saying, from a perspective of rural women in Kenya, these are the things we need. If we allow for the devastation of the forest, it means that women have, instead of walking 5 miles for firewood, they have to walk 10 miles for firewood. They build fewer fires, their children have a less varied and nutritious diet. They're the ones who carry water and so forth. So sort of grassroots environmental priorities that differ from place to place and start with the immediate concerns of people inside their communities, inside their families. To just pick up on this question also of the trains and the transport and what exists, you know, sometimes we think there's a lot of opposition in this country to public transport from certain quarters, okay? That it's an attack on liberties and the automobile and all of this stuff, okay? Yet in surprising ways and surprising places, public transport has become very popular. One of them, for instance, is Salt Lake City, you know, one of the most conservative states in the nation. And a train system was introduced, and it has way exceeded the volume of ridership. People say, wow, this is a great thing. But they stop seeing it as a liberal thing. They just see it as a great train, you know. But before, it was about government, like interfering with my freedom to drive. And in the state of Wisconsin, where I lived for a long time, just before Governor Scott Walker, who I'm sure you've all heard about, was elected, the Obama administration was distributing money for train systems. And one of the ideas was to link Milwaukee, Madison, Chicago, Twin Cities, and create a regional transport system that would give people mobility, link up these different areas. And Scott Walker said, well, if you elect me, I'll make sure that that money, which was $800 million, will be used for highways. We don't believe in trains here. And it was a lie because in the law, it stated you couldn't transfer that money from trains to highways. But he was elected and he gave the money back. And one of his top officials said, trains, that's like a 19th century thing. He'd obviously never been to Tokyo. But, it was like, we're America, we don't need it. And the trains were actually going to be built in Milwaukee, so there were a lot of jobs attached to this. And the money went to train system in California instead, okay? So these debates about the ideology of public transport are very alive in communities across the nation. And so I'm really glad that you brought that question up.
You can go first. Oh, I have the mic. Okay, I'll go first. I have a question. It's a little unrelated. It goes back to the concept of the Anthropocene in general. And you mentioned in your essay that the Anthropocene as an archive and a way to see what social relationships and unequal social relationships are like at this time. But to me, that raises the question of, like, if this is the Anthropocene and it's the era of the human, then who is it that is going to be studying the archive? So I guess I wanted to ask you who you imagine the archivist to be.
Well,
That's a very interesting question. I think in a lot of documentaries and a lot of books that are coming out around this, they create like a fictional geologist called, one book was, she was called Olivia, and she exists in the year 10,000, and she's looking back and describing, because it's very difficult to humanize all this stuff. I mean, it just seems so big, like where do you even get a handle on it? So you'll have these documentary films and books where they invent somebody to observe because, you know, we're not there. So it's a kind of a paradoxical perspective. And I wanted just to add on that, you know, one of the things that I've encountered being in the humanities is that very often there are these parallel tracks. The scientists working over here and the humanities people here. And you could say, well, part of the problem with the Anthropocene is it's mostly white men in Europe, North America, Australia, and that talking among themselves. But what they're also doing is they're investing a lot of funds in think tanks in Palo Alto, saying on geoengineering, saying we're going to fix the climate. And I mean, one extreme example, I remember a geoengineer saying, well, we can figure it that we can get more stable rain patterns in the Midwest, but the data suggests that will reduce rain in the Sahel in North Central Africa. But he said, those people have a history of resilience. They'll handle it okay, you know. So, I mean, it's like almost militarizing the weather. And so we can ignore the conversations or we can try to engage and say this isn't the only way of seeing global governance. And what started to disturb me was the degree to which it was all people who were interested, who were techno-exuberant, and were connected to billionaire philanthropists, and they were huddling together and saying, hey, this is a great opportunity. We're going to redo the whole thing from Silicon Valley or wherever. And so I was thinking, like, I don't like the concept. I think there are a lot of problems with it. But I also felt if it's the big data people alone who are in that conversation, they come from the same demographic, there's a certain danger of other perspectives being left out.
So to kind of relate back to what Isabella was saying, when I was reading your piece, I was feeling like I was in some dark science fiction future, and it was very frightening. And you know, you're talking about these bosses of the biosphere, and they're really pro-technology, and they have a lot of hope about that. So it made me think that this future archivist would actually be some bioengineered person that was, you know, as they move forward and they made their own families and allies propagate. Right, because, and they would be descendant of the bosses, right? I mean, is that what you see?
Yeah, in some extreme cases. And that's why I quoted like this one book, you know, where they say, oh, by 2030, we'll all have nanobots and all that, and thinking, wow, you know, 2.5 billion people don't even have rudimentary latrines. I mean, not talking flush toilets, you're just talking. So that to me is one of the key questions, is the technology's got to be part of the answer. I mean, absolutely. But there's a sleight of hand whereby for a lot of these people, the invention of something new is a good in itself, even if the distribution is completely screwed up. In other words, invention doesn't guarantee distribution, particularly under the sort of neoliberal inequality that we're suffering from now. So I think asking those kind of questions of the techno elite is really important.
Okay, so I think like eating meat, like beef in general, I believe that's like one of the main reasons why global warming. So do you think that's the main, if we reduce meat consumption on Earth, you think we could maybe reverse the effects of global warming and maybe like save the environment? Or you think there's other stuff that's needed other than, because I'm focused more on like meat consumption. That's what I think is like damaging the Earth the most, and and you know, because we use a lot of resources to feed domesticated animals for meat, you know. And that's my first question. And the last one, I wanted to know, like, since you say you in Africa, you focus on Africa, I wanted to know what do you think will be the future of Africa, since China's in Africa, so-called developing it, and I know, like, they're creating pollution in Africa also, so I want to know what you think is going to be the future of Africa. Okay.
That's two big questions. So the first question, yes, definitely. You know, the scale of beef and hog farming, particularly, is a huge, huge problem, both environmentally and in terms of immediate regions that where these farms exist, but also in terms of the use of finite resources, limited resources. So it's a huge part of the picture. And so I don't think there's one solution, but different people, I find, are working on different aspects of it. So somebody will be working on public transport or emissions. Somebody else will be working on consumption of meat, which is a huge, huge contributor. Somebody else will be working on changing farming practices so that you have less of what you have in many parts of, for instance, India, where you have Monsanto controlling the seeds, and the seeds have to be bought again each year. They're genetically engineered in such a way that rather than storing the seeds from one year to another, you have to go back and to the bank to get money to buy the seeds. Then you have a bad year, then you're in debt, then they take your land away, then the farmer drinks the fertilizer and commits suicide. I mean, that may sound dramatic, but that's like 250,000 Indian farmers have died that way. You know, and so this creation of debt, the various ways in which debt culture is created, has had a very, very big part in this, as opposed to small-scale sustainable farming, where you never had this kind of agribusiness and you never had these global transnational profiteers coming in and interfering with perhaps modest but sustainable units of land. And so then those people are displaced from the land and they go to the margins of these mega cities and they try to scramble an existence there. And that's a pattern you see in many, many parts of the world. But I really do think that the meat industry is a big part of it. I mean, with regard to Africa, it's 54 countries, so it's a lot of different places, a lot of different systems. China came in need of resources and influence, and their practices have been different from the colonialists from France and UK and US and even South Africa, where you've had internal colonialism going into Africa. But you can, when China sneezes, you know, everybody else catches the flu in places like Zambia, where all their copper was going to China. So I think one of the things that you've seen is at least at the popular level in a lot of countries, people saying we shouldn't be so dependent on one product and one country, one set of relationships. If China loses interest in us, then are we completely screwed, you know? So that's a debate that I see happening in a number of different African countries, of like diversifying the economy and not replacing one set of international dependencies with a superpower with another set.
So, like, for example, you know, the United States has, like, the most debt in the world. And so I think that's what sort of allows us to do a lot of things that we do, because we have so much access to credit. We're allowed to, you know, subsidize things that shouldn't really cost as low as they do or things like that. And so then it makes me think about, so and when you talked about the farming practices, you know, the Caribbean was destroyed by U.S. bringing their food in there that's cheap and, again, subsidized and debt-ridden and follows the model you mentioned. I was thinking, like, what would be the role of, like, a neutral lender in the world market? You know, I guess similar to the World Bank or IMF, but it doesn't have the same set of contingencies on, you know, keeping the traditional roles of colonial powers, on having countries become self-sufficient and sustainable in, like, a closed-loop sort of system. So why can't you allow the Caribbean to develop internally, or Africa, let them develop internally, let them diversify without needing China to do anything at all. You know, just where can they get the money? So, you know, all the Western powers have the capital to keep themselves going indefinitely, but these countries can develop internally and diversify their economies, but they need a neutral lender to do that without contingencies of you have to trade with us if we give you money.
It's funny because we were just reading Wretched on Earth in another class, and one of Fanon's main points were that most of the development is seen as having occurring, is seen to take place in a city. And his critique of that is that these cities are just sites of destruction for the mother countries. And his suggestion was decentralization and go through this slow development in the countryside, which would be a very different process, something different than what we imagine capitalism to be today. And I think it's a political question more than it is a developmental question, because it's a set of politics that come into play where we start talking about how will nations or groups begin to develop. And it's a question of what type of examples have we seen that could give us some type of imagination of an alternative as opposed to what we actually have, especially when we talk about the involvement of groups like the IMF, other people.
I would like to, you know, if I can, there is a documentary that is incredible. It's called Life and Death by Stephen Clark. I don't know, everybody should watch it. Exactly how they deciding and making to destroy a country that was self-sufficient in 5 or 6 different industries. We're fine with it. Also, Mexico was self-sufficient until like 10 years ago. And after NAFTA, I was there the first year that it was not self-sufficient. So we know stories of the, you know, the country was producing enough for them to eat. And Mexico is a big country. And 10 years ago, after NAFTA, they became.
Yeah, and I mean, some of this is happening like in Latin America. So you have some South-South bank action going on, and in Latin America, some of the countries that have become more socialist, you know, have formed blocs and are trading with each other. So when Venezuela was a little bit higher on the hog from some oil, it was, you know, lending to other countries under very good terms. So there is some of this happening, and. I mean, one of the questions in the back of my mind with some of this conversation is, you know, to what degree do you need some protectionism for this kind of development in a more environmentally just way to happen? So can you have globalization and have this, or do you need to have protectionism so that countries can develop? Or countries, or whatever the regional scale might be. And I wonder, can you speak a little? Yeah.
Okay. So we see that in this crazy electoral cycle. Okay, that you have right-wing populism and left-wing populism, both of them gravitating to the issue of trade, and a lot of other baggage attaches to that, but. From Bernie Sanders to Donald Trump, there is some overlap in terms of tapping into people's feeling they've been globalized and abandoned. Okay, and then there are many other questions as well. But I think it's a very interesting moment where even in the U.S., you know, the most affluent country, or the most powerful at least in the world, these kind of questions are hitting home, and people are saying, if you have infinite globalization, where does that leave the average person? You know, and this is clearly a debate that's happening around the world. And as I said in the piece, in the majority of countries in the world, the gap between the super rich and the poor is widening. And so there's a point of negative returns where so many people feel abandoned that the system can't hold together. Now, it doesn't mean the system is going to become ideal. It could go either way. But the assumption that you can build a small gated community and that people aren't going to eventually pull down the walls is a rather naive assumption. And I think we're seeing some kind of tremors of that in this current cycle. I'd be interested in other people's opinion of that.
And I felt like that the you know, rise in technologies being the solution exacerbates those issues, because then you have the super qualified Silicon Valley, you know, techno billionaires, then you have the people pushing the button on the machines that they create, and it sort of hurts that middle ground where if you don't have the technical training to be creating the technology, or you're just an unskilled laborer using, you know, the very simplified versions of technology. As it makes me think, unless we find a way to sort of bring, I mean, it sounds incredibly Marxist, but like the means of production, so to speak, on a more equitable scale, it almost seems like with a finite amount of resources, you have like a Mad Max sort of scenario. Or, you know, because I actually read about this in an ecological economics paper, there was a matrix that was, you know, technical optimism, pessimism, and then finite resources or infinite resources. And depending on how you plug those into the matrix, you have Star Trek or Mad Max. So it's kind of like, those seem to be, so what do you think, you know, the role of, I guess, making technology more equitable, like could that be a possible solution, or just production in general, making that more equitable, like that seems to be promising, but again, how do you take all this consolidated wealth and power from the people that you refer to in your paper and spread it without sounding, I mean, you could sound Marxist without sounding too radical, you know?
It's Well, I guess the thing I would emphasize is that we need a certain level of imagination and just exploring the possibilities for the future. I think oftentimes we get caught up in scenarios of things to be either or, one way or another. I think creativity plays a very valuable or central role, and maybe the lack of it is often a part of the problem. And when I say creativity, oftentimes in the groups that aren't usually having this conversation about these wider geological questions. So especially when it comes to production and the widening gap between the haves and the have-nots. So I think it's a creative question, and one that we just think about a different future outside of the usual terms, and hopefully some type of mobilization can grow from that. I mean, you take simple ideas like the 1% and mobilize, but what if some of those mobilization efforts actually have imagination beyond just targeting the rich, but also thinking about the rich need to get with a different type of program, because this is where we're going. I think that's where we need to be. Even a Marxist idea of what the future can be still leaves us with questions that we need to ponder, especially we talked about the gaps between the haves and the have-nots. That goes beyond class.
Yeah. Yeah, great.
Oh, I think that a huge component of that, though, is like our obsession with individualism.
Yeah. For example, people, you know, want to live alone or only with their own family, and not that we need to all live on communes, although some of us can do that. That's great. But this idea that if you are like successful and young in New York, like you live in your own studio or loft, like you kind of, it's a measure of success in New York to like not have roommates, instead of like, it could be a measure of success to like build a strong community within the people that you live with, whether or not you're related to them. And especially since we have such a housing crisis in this country, but also in New York, I think kind of like restructuring the way that we think about housing and the way that we think about what land can be used for and like how to like share land more and share space more is very important, with the like decreasing consumption, changing the way that our economy functions, and changing, that's like something that the have-nots can do without, even before you even like have more, you know. It's kind of like that whole like we have to have more to like not no longer be in the have-nots. But I think that distribution of resources amongst ourselves is very important.
Yeah, I just want to pick up on that. In one of the earlier conversations this week, you know, we were talking about how early in the early part of the 20th century, when there was a lot of socialism, a lot of communism, a lot of immigration, and a lot of foment, that was the point at which the federal government started encouraging and subsidizing and giving tax rebates for home ownership. They wanted people to own so that they wouldn't foment revolt. Okay, renters are much more volatile than homeowners. You know, if you've got a lawnmower, you're probably not going to rise up, you know. So there's a history to that. And I think this question of hyper-individuation as the site of aspiration, of self-valuation, has become a huge problem. And, you know, I've been around long enough to see it change and in some sense get more acute. That this idea that there are other forms of living. Some of those are in the past, and some of those are from other cultures. And it's one of the things that always frustrates me about the electoral debates is that how difficult it is for people to refer to experiments in other parts of the world without seeming anti-American or elite or whatever it is. You know, if say there's a needle exchange program in, or sex education program that's working in Netherlands, or some system of controlling the tides, like, why not talk about that, see if it's any good, see if it's applicable, see if it's not. But let's have a discussion. Somebody else is doing it differently, and they have way fewer abortions, and they don't have a pro-life movement. How does that work, you know? So maybe that's a good thing. Maybe that should be part of the discussion. Maybe it should be something that's happening in Brazil or elsewhere. There are experiments at different levels all around the world all the time. And I think much of the most powerful energy comes at lower levels of organization and governance, at the city or at a community, saying, we're going to do this way, because if we wait for the federal government to do it, it's just never going to happen. You see that with the urban gardening movement, with many of these movements that have been very transformative for the way people break out of the mindset that you're referring to.
Tying this back to what Lawrence is saying about creativity in this whole discussion, I feel like, you know, when I ask my students, what is it that gives you a good quality of life? When we start having this conversation, a lot of the things that we're supposed to be thinking in terms of like GDP, gives me a good quality of life. Right? When it comes down to it, things like relationships and community, these things that are less tangible, that are less destructive to the earth, actually come up to the fore. So that I think, you know, by us helping you to think critically about some of the structures that we operate within will allow us to kind of come up with some of these alternatives. It allows us to be more creative, to look at, you know, what are the indigenous people in Ecuador doing that makes them happy, and how is that like or unlike my life? And so being open to these alternate possibilities helps us to envision kind of like being out of the New York City rat race, and, you know, how nice it would be to share an apartment where, you know, a different person cooks every night. You come home to a nice meal, or, you know, kind of create these other possibilities that take us out of some of the structures that are leading us down a path that is quite destructive. We're getting to the end of the period. And so you should tell us what we should do. So that this doesn't happen to all of us, and that we could be, you know, help turn the tide.
I'm in the same space of experimenting and particularly trying to learn intergenerationally. I think it's a huge, huge thing. Most of what I know, I've learned from my students, and I've taught in many different places and in different countries, and so I'm always trying to think comparatively. I'm always trying to, and it's one of the great assets of Brooklyn College. You've got people from so many different backgrounds, and that it's, there are other institutions where it's much easier for a certain norm to assert itself and people to feel marginal to that discussion. I think the future is going to be much more decentered, as we know, even in this country. And that's a good thing, because it allows for a much more varied conversation about, oh, this is what my grandmother told me in Barbados or in Sri Lanka or Far Rockaway or wherever it is, and to be able to actually bring those community and family memories of what did and didn't work, or political memories from different societies, to bring those together and to kind of have the foment of a conversation. To me, that's one of the most hopeful things, and it's a particular and quite rare asset that you guys have here. And so, you know, in this week, I've learned a lot just from listening.
Economics also, and I'm just wondering if you think that's part of how we should be thinking, maybe about restructuring our economy without completely saying that capitalism is not possible, because it's that would be a big change to make, I guess, like a lot of, I mean, yeah, to bring down global capitalism would be a lot.
Yeah. So, yeah. I think bioregionalism is really important. It's the idea that you think in terms of the topography, the layout of the land, and the water system, the soil system. So the national boundaries are very, very arbitrary, as we know. And in terms of history of colonialism, they've created in their own right a lot of conflict, because those national boundaries are kind of irrational in many cases. But if you think in terms of bioregionalism, definitely there are a lot of people who are doing that, saying this is, the water comes from there. If that glacier melts, you know, in say Bolivia, wherever it is, we're without water here. That's the same system, even though that may be 5,000 feet higher up than where you live, okay? And so people have had to, in different cultural situations, recognize where their water comes from, recognize what happens if they deforest the slope above where they live in, and there's a mudslide. So I think those economies of knowledge often have taken a bioregional character. And then some of that knowledge doesn't always get transmitted, because you have migration, you have neoliberal incursions, and all sorts of other forces. But there is a lot of bioregional thinking around, and it has an economic, social, and an ecological dimension, I think.
You think college should be free? Because I'm a Bernie Sanders supporter, and I feel like people say college degrees are getting less valuable, so I feel like going into the future, you think kids, the next generation should focus on going to college? You think college should be free, or we think we should use that money for something else? That's what I'm saying. Currently, I'm a Bernie Sanders supporter, but I'm just thinking about college. If you can't get a job, right?
Yeah.
Why invest all that money into free college and stuff? That's why I'm just.
Okay, this is a big conversation, but but a very, very important one. And so I taught for 15 years at University of Wisconsin, which was a flagship research state college. I think in 1978, 75% of the operating budget came from the state. Now it's 12%. Okay, that is a huge, huge withdrawal of commitment on the part of the state. And where is that money going instead? Okay, into the private prison system, you know, many other. Yeah. So that I think this is a big question. It maybe comes back to one of the things Professor Lawrence was saying earlier, is how do we look creatively at other models? There have been other times. I mean, CUNY has been an incredible engine for upward mobility. UCLA. I mean, so many of these colleges. But once you start pushing up fees, it becomes an intolerable situation in terms of the kind of calculations of risk that people have to make, like yourself. And so how do you change public thinking to make it more public-minded around educational investment? And again, it's about long-term investment rather than immediate profit. But I mean, I would like to hear what other people here have to say.
Well, I'm gonna throw a question back at you. Matter of fact, this is a question for the whole class, which if you answer, I'll give you 2 bonus points on Tuesday. So you have to bring it to class. But the question is, what type of future do you want, and what type of education will be necessary for that future, right? So that's the question. Bring it on Tuesday and you'll have 2 extra credit points.
I got it.
I was just going to say, in terms of that question, that's a loaded question. But before that, I was saying, I think it depends on your motivation for college. So I think if you look at like statistics for like the 70s compared to now, it'll look a lot different. Because I studied this in a different class that I took. Most people used to be in college for like personal knowledge, well-being, self-development, growth. And now the focus is more like, I need to go to college because I need a job. So I can't just get a bachelor's, I need to get a master's. My major should be something that'll line me up to get a good job. You don't want to really do what you want to do because you're probably not going to get hired with that degree. So I think the focus, the conversation changed and the focus changed from the student's perspective, not just the governmental perspective, and it went from like, you know, medium for personal growth to like something that increased your employment on a resume. So I think that's also part of the conversation. Is that still the case? You know, to what level do you need to get education? Does making it more expensive then lead to less people having access to those careers if they can't afford the education? So that, I think that affects all of that.
Can we have a round of applause for Professor Nixon?